I'm just gonna say right now that I like this. I think this is like a three sentence, like three nice long sentences. Are you ready for this one? In Sabika, you will play the role of one of the nobles of the Nasrid dynasty who contributed to the construction of the monumental complex of the Alhambra and to the carving of the poems that adorn its walls. Pretty good length for a sentence. I could have done like 15 more words. I'm pro that. Long sentences for the win. You will also have to trade in Europe, the Maghreb, and the Near East to generate enough income to pay the demanding dues imposed by the Catholic monarchs. Not as long, pretty good stuff. Your final objective will be to appear in the historical texts as one of the most influential nobles of the Nasrid dynasty of that time. Could have had like 50 more words on that one, right? But like, three sentences. Like, tell me as much as you want to tell me in a sentence.
That's just called a run-on sentence, Campbell.
I'm aware and I'm a fan.
Tonight on the board, boys.
Sabika. Sabika.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast, Season 13, Episode 2. Tonight on the docket is Sabika, where you play as one of the nobles who contributed to the construction of the Alhambra. This is your board boy, Alhambra Rob.
Oh, we're doing that. This is your board boy cruising around the European TK.
This is your board boy, P.P. Bill.
Yes. And this is your board boy, Boinker. I'm so glad that Bill is back for a second episode with us. Mick Doinker, a.k.a. Cam, a.k.a. Boinker McDoinker. I'm so glad that Bill is back for a second episode, McDoinker.
Hey, Bill, thanks for coming all the way back here for our next episode.
Yeah, on the road
long
again.
Journey.
Hey,
long
Bill,
journey.
Speaking of your long journey, I wanted to talk about this last episode that we also recorded tonight, but I heard that you got held up by a car fire on the interstate on the way over here. Not your car, but you saw a car like up in flames.
Yes. Yeah. We're driving over and, you know, next thing you know, for Des Moines is standstill traffic, which is like a big deal. And then you see the smoke and then you see the actual fire. It was wild.
Was it like 10-foot flames?
It wasn't huge flames, but the smoke was definitely going.
Can I tell you guys a quick story about when I saw a car? Like, I've seen actually multiple cars go up in flames. Actually,
that same road is the only place I've ever seen a car on fire. There must be something like going on.
I'll tell you guys the reason why Cam's seen multiple cars up in flames after he tells the story.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, so I got a David Letterman's top two of times I saw cars go up in flames. The second best one. A couple years ago, I was in Villisca. I was driving through the town of Villisca. I had to meet with a client like 10 miles away. Are you guys...
Isn't that where the axe murder house is?
So there's a famous axe murder that happened at a house in Villisca. So I'm like, man, I'm going to drive by that famous house with the super unsolved crazy murder. And I drove by the Villisca house, and then like a squirrel was crossing the road when I was driving slowly by it, and the squirrel had a sock in his mouth. A full sock.
You know you can stay in that house?
Yeah, I did.
That'd
but
be freaky.
I don't think you're hearing what I'm saying. Full sock in the mouth of a squirrel. And then I get on the interstate and there's a car on the
was
other side
like,
of the
was
road.
Was this like a tube sock?
Yeah, it's like a full
like a big long.
It wasn't an ankle sock. It was like it had the whole calf part on it, and like a sweat sock.
Any stripes?
I don't think it was sweat. I don't think it was like a baseball sock.
Okay.
But then I was on the interstate.
Hold on, was there a leg in the sock?
Oh, good point. I should have checked. No, it was flopping around. It was like I was like, is that like? There definitely wasn't a leg because I would have seen you know the shape of the sock because I was like, what is that? And I took a picture. I think I could probably show you the picture and the sock in the mouth.
It's probably just nesting, man.
Yeah. Well, good call on the sock. It's like a little sleeping bag for a squirrel, you know? rated to 40 degrees Fahrenheit.
That's the squirrel's nugget right there.
Yeah. The nest leg. So then I was driving back and there was a car in fully on fire. So it was a threefer. But the best...
Wait, was
number one?
Was that sock from the fire? Do you think? Yeah.
Is the three? The three fur is the murder house.
The murder house, the squirrel, sock, and then the flight, fire. Yeah, okay, yeah. The three unrelated things. But the okay, so
I
this
think
is
they call that hitting for the cycle.
The cycle. Well, you got to get a home run too, because that was a single, a double, and a triple. Actually, I think the single was seeing the house. The double was seeing the car on fire, and then the triple was seeing the sock in the mouth of the squirrel.
You didn't hit a homer?
Well, no, I guess not. I mean, maybe the squirrel sock was a homer sort of deal. But so my dad was a, like, when I was, until I was like 13 or 14, my dad was a youth pastor. Then he became the principal of the school that was attached to the church, and now he's the pastor of that church. He's actually retiring in a couple months. That's just setting the stage. My dad and mom used to have all the youth group kids over every Wednesday night as like a midweek deal, and they would serve food. And so I'm like 12 years old, and all the high school kids come over every week, so I know all these kids pretty well. And one night, one of them comes rolling in to the house hot. I mean, he's like, he busts in the front door like Kramer, you know what I'm saying? And he's going, And we're like, what is going on? I'm going to try not to say his name at all. But he's like, oh, my car. And we go out, and like the front of his car is smoking. There's like probably 50 teenagers on the lawn watching from across the street. And he's like, I was driving through leaf piles on the way over here, like kind of bouncing through them. I thought it'd be fun. Like he was driving through like a, you know, and his leaves got caught up under his car, and the whole thing is smoldering. And it's like the whole car looks like a Cheech and Chong movie.
Where,
like,
smoke.
If you open the door, like, it just come rolling out. And some, like, there's some neighbor across the street, like, goes over towards it, and you're like, get away from there, it's on fire. And the second the dude walks away, seriously, the thing goes, like, 20 feet up. Foosh! all in one go.
The car does?
Yeah. Oh. And can you imagine you're, like, 17 years old? It's already a tough time in life, you know? A lot of emotions. And everybody, probably including the girl that you like, I don't know which girl
they figure out what happened?
Yeah, he drove through a bunch of piles of leaves, and they all got stuck right under the engine. And, like, so the leaves caught the car on fire.
Oh, and then that just combusted the gas tank.
Yeah, and it got
so
hot, yeah, that, like, when it hit the gas tank, boosh!
Was there like an explosion? Like, did you feel?
Well,
a shock?
Or? It wasn't a kaboom. It was like the car is smoking, and then the car is like wet. Like, you know when like that moment when you get the marshmallow a little too close.
Yeah.
Wow, that's probably a really good.
That's
analogy.
Really apt. Yeah.
So anyway, I had to take my car, and I'm sorry. I only want to talk about one game tonight.
This is the car guys podcast.
I had to take my car to the shop today. It got fixed today, thank God, because car, like, good mechanics are so busy all the time. And very fortunately was able to be fixed today, but I turned my car off today when going into a meeting with, like, I was going to have a client sign some paperwork, just stopping by for a minute, turn the car off, take the key out. Air conditioner stays fully on. Have you ever heard of anything? I didn't even know that could happen. I thought when you turned the car off, it was just off. You know, like the keys in the ignition still, and it's like you can still like roll down the window or whatever. The ignition comes out. Like it has like a, it's like a, like, you know, the car has like enough energy to be like a chicken with its head cut off where it like still goes for like a second. But like I was in the building for 10 minutes and the air conditioner is just running the whole time.
Did you realize it till you came back out?
No, I realized it right away, and I was like, this is weird. Because, like, sometimes the radiator fan stays on for a minute to cool down the engine, you know, when it's hot outside in a car. But, like, this is the full inside blower. And I called the guy who normally fixes my car over in Cedar Rapids, and he's like, yeah, that happens. Did you guys know that?
No.
So, yeah, so I called up, I went over, I found a place called B&T Auto, the super nice guy named Ben.
B and what?
B&T okay. Auto. Ben fixed my car. Cool dude. It was over by Pho 888 and like kind of the Vietnamese part of town. Cool old Vietnamese guy was like, oh, yeah, I can fix this today. And yeah, he's my savior. And I'll go to B&T Auto anytime.
Do you know what he did?
Yeah, he just had to get a part and like put
turn
a whole new part in. Yeah,
he kicked it.
Yeah, yeah, he opened the thing up and was like, he got a pistol out and just shot it.
he uninstalled your air conditioner.
Yeah.
No, he fixed it. It's great. And
he actually
and you know what?
They have this little like knob that you turn, you know, from like 3 to 0. That was fine. Yeah.
Yeah, but no, he fixed it. So.
All right, you guys want to know the secret why Cam sees so many cars on fire?
Yes.
He lights them on fire.
Oh.
That's exactly what he does.
Like, this car is on fire.
This Cam is
so
on fire.
So he actually stuffed all those leaves in that kid's car, and then he drove over.
Cam, yeah. Are you Boinker McPyro Doinker? Are
you going to do better than that?
No, I can't. I
Boinker McArsonoinker.
Yeah.
Well, that's pretty
How
good.
How about,
yeah,
I can't think of a good one, so I guess you guys are, yeah, doing better than me.
All right. Rob, what games have you been playing?
Boinker Mc. Instead of Doinker, it can be like Doinkar.
Now
I
just
think of the...
now I just want to see like a looping GIF of Campbell
Flammable D'Souza
being like Beavis from Beavis and Butthead saying fire, fire.
Did you guys catch me when I said Flammable D'Souza? That's pretty good. Can you like Campbell D'Souza,
yeah.
Flammable D'Souza.
I wish the audience could see Campbell's face when he's trying to make these things up.
I
it's pretty
it.
Good. Yeah. It's
like
pretty
the
good.
Face, yeah.
Yeah.
So, game I want to talk about, Anomaly. This is from 2019. It is from Starling Games. It's by Thomas Degenice L'Esperance. Anyway, this game I bought from Dungeons Gate at like there was a thing out in the parking lot at the Fire Trucker where like we all kind of did like a game sale thing, and Dungeons Gate took some games to sell like on clearance. And they had this one out there. I'm like, I heard about this game. And guess what, guys? It's Hidden Movement. That's why I was like always interested in it. And it's Hidden Movement where everyone's hidden, even like both sides of the team. So one player is the alien. Up to 3 other players are the humans. It really gives me Escape from the Aliens and Outer Space vibes because everyone's hidden. Plus, you have items you can use. The coolest mechanism of this game, though, is... you always have to play a card to do an action, and you either play it face down to do a basic action, which is like move, and there might be some other thing you can do, I can't remember. But if you want to do any special actions, which include attack, you have to give the alien the card, and then they get to use that card later. The other half of the card has an alien action on it. So it's like, do I want to do this? But I got to give him this thing, and like you have to talk about it openly in front of him. That's very neat. The other neat thing is there's like an inner, a middle, and an outer zone of the board. And then every zone is, I think there must be 12 total zones. And each zone has 3 different descriptors of like, this is an icy place or a fiery place. Or this is the middle and this has this symbol. And then when you move, you put a card face up to show what zone you moved into. And so the icons are kind of all over the board. And then when you move again, you slide that to your left and you put another face card up. So then all the humans have 2 cards face up. So that, and then the alien and the human have these little markers where you can kind of mark where the other people could be at. And so for the alien to be able to track the humans, it's really cool because they can look at your card list and be like, okay, well, he could have been here to go there to go. And the alien has to show themselves to kind of attack. And you can attack these barrels and just blow it up, but then you could damage other players because you don't know the player was there. So you have to be paying attention to like where your buddies are, and you can't really talk about where you are, you know. So everyone knows who the alien is and who the humans are, which is different from Escape from the Aliens. But the rest of it kind of gives me the same vibes. And we played it twice in a row because the first time we just stomped the alien hard because we were kind of learning. The second time the game took longer, and the alien eventually won, but... I like to play this one more. I think it plays in like in an hour or two. So
sounds fun.
It's pretty neat.
I know what Tim's about to talk about.
So speaking of Escape from Aliens in Outer Space, we had an Escape from Aliens Outer Space game, I don't know, a couple days ago or whatever.
Probably the most exciting one I've ever been a part of.
Yeah.
You played it on Tuesday?
We did.
When I was gone?
We'll play it again. Oh. We need to play it again.
I'll bring it like every week. So let's just play it. I did eat Campbell.
Was he also an alien?
He was also an alien.
Second turn of the game.
Oh, yeah. That happened. That happened at Cardboard Caucus a couple years ago.
Yeah, and I think it was my payback because I think I killed Jared on the second turn of the game one time and we were both aliens, too. Yeah. So.
And come to find out, like, I just read some of the abilities wrong. There's no possible way a human could have been where he was at. And, and I just ate him anyway. Yeah. So.
Oops.
Well, and, like, I think everybody thought I was, like, a human and I was just lying. And he's like, ha-ha, Cam, I'll just eat, you know, just in case, you know.
Oops. And then the unfortunate part of that game is you're out then.
Yeah, you're just out. Like, if you're a human and you get eaten, you get to keep playing.
Right, because you turn into an alien.
You turn into an alien. If you die as an alien, you die in real life.
That's true.
Hey, Bill, have you been playing anything that you want to talk about?
I've actually been playing two things. The real quick one is the Logo game. I don't know if anyone's played this. This
sounds familiar.
It's kind of a...
This is like a mass markety type.
Is it kind of like Kazoo That Tune, but for logos?
Yeah, basically, yes. And it's kind of a standard trivia game, but one of the fun things is, you know, it's all about logos and marketing. I actually learned a decent amount, but I think the most shocking thing is how much you realize advertising has been like drilled into your head.
Oh, I know that. Yeah, Bo is a walking advertisement billboard because of all the... He can sing so many theme songs and things, and we've played games where, like, you know what that company is, or you know what that, like, to look at, like, a young kid for that, like, or even he could name a bunch of trucks and cars and stuff when we played that one game.
Yeah.
It's because there's ads for them everywhere, and guess what? YouTube shows ads. There might
all
not
all the time.
He doesn't watch commercials, but advertisements still out there.
Mike, we went and got, my phone was dying. I went and got a new phone, Pixel 7. My six-year-old was like, sweet, that's got a VPN. Like, dude, do you know what a VPN is? No, but that's what it says on the ad.
Yeah.
So,
excellent. I mean, I still think about, like, chewing gum songs I heard when I was, like, four. Like, the Big Red song, remember that one? Kiss a little longer.
Yeah.
Stay close a little longer. Longer with Big Red.
Damn you, marketing people. I'm pretty sure I played the Logo game. It's been a long time.
Yeah. So, shout out to Tim for that one. Different Tim than on this podcast. Yeah. But then the other thing that I've been playing is Frosthaven. And that has been an absolute... I don't know. It's definitely been a trip. I think it's been a very meandering trip, almost. Because it's Gloomhaven, but everything is juiced up. Like, there's just more of everything. There's more... items to build. There's more outpost phases. There's more to do with each characters. Like my character currently is a bug swarm that swaps back and forth between melee range and faraway range. And the swaps are on your action cards. And if you lose those action cards, you lose the ability to swap between characters, and then your character can exhaust. So it's for those that like Gloomhaven, I'm sure if you have Frosthaven, you're loving it. It's very much just more Gloomhaven.
Did they make the game easier to set up at all?
No. It's harder.
They did. I just saw the email. I think it was not part of the Kickstarter or whatever, but I believe there's either another Kickstarter, you can go buy it. In Jaws of the Lion, they used the book.
Yeah.
It's like a book. There's a book for Frosthaven to set.
Oh, now there is?
Yeah,
or they came
it's
with
coming.
From...
No, it did not come
I saw
it.
That
it's
they just...
Out.
Gloomhaven just... I don't know. I'm Gloomhaven. Like, I played the original Gloomhaven, but, like, I'm out of the whole Gloomhaven verse. Like, quit putting stuff out for Gloomhaven. Like, they did a Kickstarter. I'm not even sure what all they did with it. Like, they're doing, like, a Gloomhaven 2nd edition.
They're doing mini upgrades.
And it looks like there's, like, a mini Gloomhaven game or something.
Yeah, bugs,
like,
and buttons.
Yeah, I don't know what that's even about. But
it looks... So, you basically... It looks like it's... I don't know how many players it is, but basically, it's... You have, like, a card of a bad guy or an enemy or whatever, maybe a boss and a couple other enemies. You track it on the cards. It's a deck of cards. And then you have your own deck of cards that you play.
I don't know.
It looks interesting. I mean, I have Frosthaven. I haven't even...
My favorite part of Gloomhaven was, like, doing the map and making the choices and stuff. Like, the game was fun.
I think Frost Haven ramps that up to like 20.
I'm sure it does. Like, yeah. I like that part because it's like that's like the legacy feeling for me, and I like
you might like Frost Haven more because, like, you know how there was like, I don't know, maybe like 5 to 10 minutes of that after you finish the campaign. Now there's like 20 minutes.
Ooh,
so
that's like my favorite part of the game. But, you know, like, I can't just justify that. That price tag is just dumb.
It's like a 40-pound box,
There is a lot of stuff, but, like, I'm not going to play that game that many times.
Print me an insert. We'll play together.
I do think that's kind of the best way.
True.
Kudos to Frosthaven, because I think, like, when they made Gloomhaven, I think it was genius that they said, hey, we should make a game that's just like this, but kind of an entry point, because I know that people are hearing that this game is cool, so let's give them like an entryway into it. And I think it's equally awesome that when they made the second Gloomhaven, you know, that they didn't go, okay, like if you play a video game and you love the video game and you play Tomb Raider 1 and then you go play Tomb Raider 2 or, you know, anything, it's just like you're a lot of times getting more of the same thing. And I think that in a board game, especially a cooperative board, like legacy board game, to be like, hey, this one is for the people who love Gloomhaven and want it to be crazier, I think that's a smart thing to do instead of just being like, oh, I guess I just got like 100 more Gloomhaven scenarios.
Yeah, if you want that, you just go get Gloomhaven second edition.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, I think it's awesome that they were like, hey, let's crank this thing up to 11 for the and like, what are they going to do for Shadehaven?
Yeah. Can you play Frosthaven solo?
And Spikehaven.
You play two hands.
And
Magmahaven.
Yeah, Magmahaven. So, and then,
like, when I played Gloomhaven, I played two player, and I feel like that was probably where it was at. I felt like you had to do more stuff.
We played
probably more people.
I mean, so Bill was in my Gloomhaven group. I think that was a very fond experience. We played for probably
full year.
Yeah, entire year. Yeah, we played, what, 70, 80, 80 scenarios or whatever.
Yeah.
It was very, but our player count varied all over the place. Like, mm-hmm. we had a guy that could make it, some couldn't make it. So it was, you know, 2, 3, 4 players all over the place. I think it scales really well doing all of that. I never felt like you got to do more or less at two players.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We did get to the point where it's like, we got to juice this thing like way out. It was all the way on hard. And then it was like, well, like, we were still just smacking through it. So
I think another thing, too,
it gets
is
easier as you go on.
I mean, it felt like it did.
Well, another thing with Frosthaven, too, is it's hard. Like, right out of the gate at the stock difficulty, like, we failed our like second scenario, like coming out of the gate at like its normal setting. So I think this is for the people, the designer, the artist, they were like, all of our ideas that we wanted to throw in the original, but we were like, maybe we should tone it down a little bit. They did that and more in Frosthaven.
My Gloomhaven digital group, because like I'm playing all of Gloomhaven way late, but it's Dre, who is one of the Louisiana boys that we love, then Jason, you know, Des Moines gamer, and then a couple other people who maybe not everybody knows real well, but we have been losing like fairly often on, and I think we're just playing on normal, but we decided we were going to like make all of the decisions that you would never really make if you were playing like the campaign, like every time we have the opportunity to like do something like kind of evil, we're like, well, why not, you know? So for those of you who played Gloomhaven, I don't know how many people have ever made this choice in a real campaign of Gloomhaven that wasn't digital, but we're like, yeah, Jexera, we'll help you. We'll help you take over the city and like the fourth story mission. And so we're like helping these like skeletons and necromancers. Have you ever tried this mission?
I mean,
it's unbelievably hard.
Yeah. Like the first mission of Gloomhaven is very hard. Like it's kind of like a gateway, I guess.
In Gloomhaven, if you fail the mission, like you have to redo it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I never really felt like when in Gloomhaven, we didn't fail very many missions. I'm not sure that we really ever failed, but if we did, I think we just kind of said, nah.
Fail, though. We win, though. Is that what you said?
Well, it's one of those things, and there's a lot of games like that where I'm like, nah, I'm not going to do that again. Let's keep going, because there's a billion missions, right? Yeah.
I feel like unless you get crushed right out of the gate, like if you get to the very end of a mission and you just missed it, the likelihood that you're going to go back through and be like, I want this same experience again, but I want to succeed this time. That is not going to happen.
Yeah, and you're it's like how I got with time stories after a while, where I'm like, I'm not going to go back through and make all these same decisions again. Okay, how do I actually just make it through this thing? And that's ultimately why Seventh Continent was similar for me. I was playing that kind of solo, and like I'd get to a thing and I'd get stopped. And I'm like, do I really want to redo all this thing? Nope. Let's just walk through the story. And that's why I got rid of the game, like, because I don't want to redo stuff I already redid.
Have you guys come to grips with the fact that you can't play every board game yet? Like, you can't play every board game. You can't hug every cat. You know what I'm saying?
That's why I'm just like, keep moving forward.
Yeah. That's literally the name of my financial firm that I work for.
Keep moving forward?
KMF Advisors. Yeah.
Oh,
that's what it stands for?
That is what it stands for.
Awesome.
No, I thought it was you can't hug every cat.
Can't hug every cat. What's an M word for hug?
Cam stop.
So I got another one. Jake Krause and I played games for the first time in a long time at the Fire Trucker. And he messaged me and was like, hey, I see Whistle Mountain is for sale for like $20. And like him and I played my copy of it like 2 years ago. And we're like, we had fun with that, right? And so he bought it. And I ended up bringing my copy. And we ended up playing it. Whistle Mountain is by Scott Caputo and Bezier Games. It is an interesting game. I don't know why I haven't brought it out again since then. Like, I think it just kind of was one of those things that happened during COVID and then just never made it back out to play. But I played it like two more times in the past month, and it's a really neat worker placement game where you kind of build the worker placement spots because you're building these machines, and it's all kind of like strategically placing your blimps around these things to get resources, and then you got to rescue your guys before they fall in the water, and then you're trying to like promote them over to the safe spot. So every time you build above this spot on the board, the water rises, and there's like this little pegboard that you actually like start putting like these little water planks on, and then the game ends. And you can kind of push the game as fast as you want because every time you build up there, one of the planks in the water rises. It's a really neat game. If you like worker placement, kind of wacky, there's lots of different powers, and I think the game has a lot of real playability because there's so many different buildings in this game.
I'm gonna say,
has anybody else played this game?
I have. I want to say something that is kind of like, if you were the designer of Whistle Stop and Whistle Mountain and you're listening to what I'm saying about Whistle Stop and Whistle Mountain, sorry in advance, but I kind of feel like Whistle Stop, I played once and I was like, well, this is, I'll need to play this again. And it's like, it's almost like the person, like when the company came back and was like, hey, could you design another game in the Whistle series? And he's like, sure, indubitably. And they're like, okay, but could you take a bunch of acid first? And he's like, okay. And then he came up with, like, it's so wild how, like, it's a game about, like, building blimps up into the sky. And Whistle Stop was like, oh, put your train tracks down and collect packages on the way to the like west across the United States. You know what I'm saying?
Right. I get you. No, it is a wacky game. It's very interesting.
Yeah, it's a cool game.
It's also by Luke Laurie, who did Dwellings for Eldervale, which really like. Yeah.
DOE?
I haven't played that in a while either.
Yeah, it's there on my list.
Hey, here's an idea for a game based on the logo game. What if there is a game where you had to come up with new catchphrases for famous companies? That'd be fun.
Oh, that'd be a great party game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what you could use in that one? Chilling with my Pepsi, like, sheesh. We were talking about that being a Pepsi commercial.
That game has to exist.
Coming up with
a little sweet.
If it doesn't, TM, 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 TM.
Hey, can I talk about the game? Or do you have another one?
I just want to hit the other one I played with Krause. I let him pick one out of his bag. I was like, hey, let's play this one. Because I never played it before. He had Aquasphere in his bag.
By
Stefan Feld. Dennis Lohausen is the artist. And it's Hall Games, which is the same company that did Bonfire.
And it feels like Bonfire, doesn't it?
That's what I said, just a little bit. I think it's because of like all the interconnecting, locking things.
Yeah.
And how, I don't know, just how different things work. I thought it was
you
neat.
Like, to move around.
I think I passed on it because people told me it was meh. But, like, I liked it.
I think
I mean,
it's
like,
really fun.
It's not, like, my favorite Feld, but it's probably in my top, it could be in my top five. I don't know.
The theme is so
on the bottom end.
I don't know why, but I love like the art direction and theme in it. I'm like, yeah. You're like, oh, you're in a science lab under the water and you have to catch octopuses.
Yeah, and then like the
cool thing.
I don't know. He had played it a few times and I never played it, and like the game was fairly close, so I don't think there's like a huge learning curve on that one.
I thought it was really fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really fun.
So don't sleep on Aquasphere, folks, like I did.
All right,
go give it a shot.
Hey, I'm about to talk about a game that I never, ever thought I would like and has turned into like a granite strength three-boing for me over the last couple of weeks. I slept on this like a fool back in the days of my more preconceived notions on how much I would like a game based on what type of game it is. My little brother kickstarted Burgle Brothers. Burgle Bros. It's a cooperative heist game that, on the surface, I think is really kind of like so many cooperative games where you take your turn, then the game does something against you. And then the next person takes their turn, and the game does something against you. And you can have a quarterback who's like, hey, I think you should go there and do that thing. And the goal of the game is to ransack a three-story building with a safe on each floor, and you have to crack the safe, and then everybody has to get out, and if anybody gets caught by a guard, the game's over. Okay, I've played Pandemic before, bro. I've played Forbidden Island. I don't need to play this game, right? That's how I felt about it. And so I played it.
But that theme is so much cooler.
It is a cooler theme. Like, I was kind of interested in it when, like, but, like, as I was playing it, and this is, again, a few years ago, and I think, you know, maybe I was a little sleepy that day anyway, and I definitely hadn't reached the level of I love every game that I'm at now, you know? But I played it a couple times on BGA when it came out, and I don't think I did the tutorial, and I was just kind of, like, taking actions and, like, kept getting caught by the guards, and I was like, this isn't really that fun. Well, Dave, our friend Dave, who's Quahog in the Discord and on BGA, he invited me to a two-player game of Burgle Brothers a couple weeks ago, and I kind of got, like, stomped on. Like, but I was like, Dave, I'm sorry, I don't know what I'm really doing. Like, let me go play the tutorial. And as I played the tutorial, I was like, huh, this is kind of interesting. So let me set up Burgle Brothers for those of you, because I really just encourage everybody who's leery of co-op games to go play the tutorial on BGA and go play a two-player game with somebody. I've been playing it. We're playing a game with Tim and Jake and Dave and me, and I think, I don't know if I feel the same way about a four-player game, and I'm not going to take the time to talk about why, but I think this game is rad at two players, and here's why. So you have your basic idea of, like, go crack the safe, and then, like, the building is like a 4x4 grid, and then there's three floors of it. So, like, if you find the stairs on floor one, you can go to, like, the corresponding, like, 3D tic-tac-toe, the next floor up. Basically, you take your turn, and when you end your turn, there's a guard on each floor, and that guard is going to move a couple of spaces towards his next destination. And whatever floor you're on, the guard will move. So if you end your turn on floor one, the guard on floor one moves. If you end your turn on floor two, the guard on floor two moves. What is so cool about this game is it's so easy to learn how to play it, and then the random generation of the building and the abilities that the player characters have make me feel like I'm in a heist movie 100% of the time I'm playing the game. Every time I play the game. So, and there's such simple ideas for characters. So there's like an acrobat who can, like, as a free action, like, flip into a room adjacent to them where a guard is, and the guard doesn't see them. And then as long as they're not in the room at the end of their turn, they don't lose any stealth. Like, you have, like, your health is, like, anytime you're in a room with a guard, the guard, you have to, like, use some of your stealth, which is your health, you know, and if you run out of stealth and the guard sees you and the game's over. Every time you're looking around the floors, you have to, like, search the floors, because the way you crack the safe is by uncovering all the tiles in, like, the column and row of the safe. And then you go to the safe and you, like, spend actions to add dice there, and then you roll the dice. And once you hit all the numbers that are on the rooms you've uncovered, you unlock the safe. the way the walls in the building and like the different types of rooms get put together, you come up with these like devilish traps between like knowing where the guard is supposed to go on his next move and then like maybe like a room that costs three actions to go into because it's a deadbolt room. But like thematically they work so good because if somebody else is in the deadbolt room, they can hold the door open for you. Then it only takes one action to go in. And like the walls will set up these traps because you'll have like a motion detector room where if you don't stop when you go into the room, like you're going to trigger an alarm. And if you trigger an alarm, the guard changes where he's going to on his turn. They're such fun. Like all of the heist people have really great thematic abilities, and there's two abilities, so you can choose which side of the character you play. So the acrobat, the other side, is if you're on the outside ring of the building, you can spend most of your turn to climb up or down one floor without stairs because you go out onto the ledge. There's people that can see through walls. There's hackers that can hack the rooms. There's like dudes who can like drill the safe from like the floor above, but they can't pick up the loot there. I don't know what it is, but this game has captured my heart in a way no co-op game has, and that's why I've talked about it for 5 minutes. So thank you. Like, I can't tell you enough how fun this game is. And you know what? I've played like 10 games of it with Dave. We've never won.
Really?
Never. And we keep getting closer every time. And we always get caught in a high-tension moment because something happens. And it's always so funny because, like, the game just, like, it throws events at you. Like, if you don't take your full turn, you might get an event thrown at you. And sometimes, like, in the nick of time right before you lose, it's like, you get an item. And sometimes if you're like, we're doing great, it's like, you slip and fall down one floor, and then, like, the guard moves and hits you for, like, two stealth because it walks by you twice. And it's like, oh, my gosh. I don't know. Like, I cannot explain what is so much better about this game to me than, like, again, Pandemic or Forbidden Island or, you know, all those co-op games that kind of follow the same formula. Go play Burl Brothers, please. So, and if you want somebody to play with, I'll play a two-player game with you on PGA.
The real question is, you're a big proponent of the playlist, like a themed playlist.
Yeah.
Like, when we play TI...
I always have a playlist for every faction. Yeah.
Do you have your Burgle Bros playlist?
Oh man, well, do you know what? I will create a playlist and I will find a copy of this game, and like, and then when I play it live, we'll put on like the.
Yeah, I mean, I think I played it at BGG Con a long time ago when it came out, and I remember they had a like the 3D stand on it, so it was like
that's really cool.
I remember thinking that was cool. I don't remember thinking the game was very cool, but you're making me want to try it again. I mean, it's been years.
You know what it is? I love like randomly generated stuff. And for me, the situations that arise during the game feel so much like a real like heist video game or movie where it's like, how are we going to get around this room? Like I have like a stealth video game where you have to like run around a corner, like right at the exact time.
Yeah. And, they specifically mention roguelike in here in the game description.
Yeah,
so.
And I love roguelike video games. So
also, there's a Burgle Brothers 2. Just
I heard it was
Burgaloo.
I heard it's not as good as the first one.
Yeah, I think I remember also hearing that, but it looks neat. Also, just to cap it off, you can buy it for $4 on Steam.
Oh, Burgle Brothers?
Yeah, and it looks like it's like got cool art and graphics and stuff.
Nice.
So.
Man, it's so fun. I love... Oh, my gosh.
All right, let's get to our main review of Sabika. Sabika is by Jermaine P. Milan. That will sound familiar when we get to our look back.
He's from Spain, so he probably doesn't pronounce his name that way, but...
Laura Bevan, and the publisher is Ludonova. It currently is a 7.9 on BGG. It came out in 2022. Its rank was 1,528 overall. 1 to 4 players, they say best at 3, 60 to 120 minutes, age 14 plus, and a 3.87 out of 5. That's a whole point bigger than our last game. Campbell, you want to talk about what we do in Sabika?
Yeah, so Sabika is really at its core a 4 action per round rondel game where You have two, like one Rondell where you take two
actions.
I really
wanted to give a Rondell joke there. But
Rondell?
Yeah, like my other brother, Rondell.
Yeah, it's a that's a cool name. Wasn't there also like a doo-wop band called the Rondells? I think there was.
No idea.
Maybe it's the Ronettes, you know, like Ronnie Spector.
There's definitely the Ronettes.
The Ronettes. Man, you could do a whole podcast about Phil Spector. Thanks, Rob. Right. Thank you for the Rondell joke, right. Rob.
This is now the Phil Spector.
Hey, welcome to the Phil cast. That guy's hair, man. Okay. There's three Rondells, and you take an action, like two of your workers on one, and then one worker on the second ring, and then one worker on the third ring. And so you just go around and each move one and take the action. Everybody takes, you know, four actions over the course of the round. What makes it kind of interesting is that, you know, you have to pay extra currency to move further than you're normally allowed to. You have to pay to activate a spot that anybody else is on, so timing is a little bit of a thing. Money is tight enough in the game where this becomes a real decision point, but money is also loose enough where it generally doesn't stop you from taking the actions less efficiently than you'd hoped. But finally, the kicker to this Rondell is that there's secondary actions you can take that are pasted on, like, in between the Rondells, so that on the first and second ring, if you go to the spot, you can take a secondary action, and there's like a better version of it for the first person who does it, and like a backup version for people who do it on later turns. And that is the gameplay. What makes it neat is you have this big, super combo wombo wobbledy dobbledy puzzle where your actions are like moving you around this map on the bottom of the board and then building buildings and like kind of tapestry sort of tiles that like link together, kind of like so many, like it, think Towat and Suyu and Pulsar, where you're kind of linking things together to like create bonuses. It's really just kind of a classic collect stuff, take things at the right time, and then like try to exploit the way to get points in maybe a roundabout sort of way. If you're a fan of Teotihuacan, the way you play this game, I think would make a lot of sense. If you've played other games by this designer, like Bitoku, kind of very similar in the world of, we're going to give you the straightforward way to do this, but a lot of times you have to go in through Bowser's backdoor, you know, castle, like in the Super Nintendo, where you come. You know, Tim, you take the things I say, and then I can just tell that your brain is doing naughty things with them.
Hey, Tim, you ever go in Bowser's backdoor?
The
Bill,
only way to
Bill,
go.
You're pure like me. You know what I'm talking about, right? We're both pure on this side, on the left side of the table.
Bowser's backdoor castle.
Yeah.
All right, that's all.
Yeah, Bowser's castle's backdoor is what I should have said.
Yeah, probably not.
Yeah. Well, let me continue. Well, to cap it off, Sabika is like your classic medium to upper medium weight Euro with some wacky wombo, some wacky combo, some wobbledy-dobble, and there is a nugget. There's things you can collect that you can spend for one coin or one pariah resource.
Yep. Yeah, the little green tokens.
Yeah, I didn't mention that. At the end of every round, you have to pay these. Like, you're collecting this resource called pariah. I don't really know what it means because it's not the classic English spelling of the word pariah, like outcast. It must be some kind of thing that I don't know. P-A-R-I-A? Yeah, anyway. Aria. Yeah, so this is why I don't usually do the board game descriptions, because I more talk about like what's fun about it and less what you're actually doing.
Cam, right. you killed it in the intro, like those sentences.
Hey, thanks. The long
pristine
sentences.
Yeah.
Well, let's get it to the table and we'll get back and give us
our
first thoughts.
Rob looks so disappointed. Is there anything you want to say about the game, Rob?
Did you explain it?
Yeah, I did. I did, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
Here is a film featuring Bill Veal and the Rondells. You can dance if you'd like. And the song, of course, is I've Been Hurt.
Oh, All right, this is DJ Cam, a.k.a. DJ Steve Walsh, a.k.a. DJ Big Boinker McDoinker, letting you know that that was Bill Deal and the Rondells. I've been hurt. I can't believe I let the other dudes gaslight me into thinking the Rondells weren't a group. That's a beautiful song, and it's one of the best ones ever. We take you now, before the second half of the podcast, to A Moment with Mo, which is the reason for my recording this. I hope you guys enjoy it. I haven't even listened to it yet, so I hope it fits real nicely with all the other stuff we're doing. A Moment with Mo.
Hey, Bo, what's up?
Today I'm here to talk about Unmatched on the Moment with Mo. We have a lot of Unmatched. So this is how I all started getting into Unmatched. So my dad told me about that there was an Unmatched tournament. I had no idea what that was, but I wanted to go to it. When we played, I really liked it. So then we bought our first copy, which was actually the Goblin Fog expansion. Then after that, we bought the Jurassic Park Velociraptor set. Then after that, we bought the Battle of the Legends 1 set. Then we bought the Jurassic Park T-Rex set. Then now we currently have our newest, Brains and Bronze.
Yeah, that one's brand new. So what... And it's funny, I actually owned Battle of Legends Volume 1 originally when it came out at Gen Con. Played it a couple times and kind of passed on it. But I would say out of every game we've ever played, I feel like this is the one Bo has latched onto the hardest. And you like it the most.
Maybe.
Is this your favorite game right now, would you say?
Yeah.
Do you think this is your favorite game you've ever played?
Yeah. So you'd
say this is your four-boying game right now?
I'm going to call it a 3-point.
It's only a 3? You're reserving the right?
Because I'm reserving because today we're also going to play...
You want to learn X-Wing?
Yeah, we're going to play and learn X-Wing. My dad already knows how to play, but we are going to play it. We just have the starter set.
Yeah, so we'll see how that goes.
We tried to play it the first time, I dropped one of the guys on the floor and it broke. And then we had to glue it back together. And then we glued it back together the wrong way. And then it broke. And then we had to glue it back together the wrong way. And then we glued it back together wrong. But no one really paid that much attention to it.
That's true. Let's go back to Unmatched, though. Our next moment with Mo, I think, will probably feature X-Wing. But with Unmatched, what do you like about Unmatched?
Skirmish.
You like battling?
Skirmish, battling, and the characters.
Yeah. You think it's funny that you can have like a T-Rex fight Dracula?
That is actually one of the matches that I've done in my bracket before.
Oh yeah, why don't you talk about your bracket?
Oh, well.
Because I was gone for a week from work, and when I came back home...
I had made a bracket, and we already did some of the bracket already. I don't remember who won, but all I know is that we needed to do 4 more battles to go on to round 2 of the bracket.
Yeah, so it's a 15-person bracket?
Yeah, because that's how many characters we have in the game.
Yeah, She-Hulk got a first-round bye, I believe.
Yeah. I probably should have picked a weaker character, because she's really strong.
I will say, out of all the guys I've played so far, Doctor Strange feels very powerful to me. He can do all kinds of crazy moving around. He has this ability where he can turn over extra cards to do more damage. I guess, let's just talk quickly about how you play Unmatched.
No, before we do that, I would like you to guess what my favorite character is. Make sure to say your idea in the comment below. I will tell you in the next Bowman with Mo.
Oh, you want everyone to guess your favorite character?
Yeah, put it
out
in
of
the,
those sets.
Yeah,
that's out of the both Jurassic Parks, the Brains and Brawn, Cobble and Fog, and Battle of Legends Volume 1. I don't know. I think the Raptors are your favorite.
No, that's not correct.
All right, well, I won't guess anymore, and we'll bring it back on the next segment and see how everybody did, if they took a guess or not.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a hint for you, not the Raptors. In Unmatched, basically you're fighting 1v1, or even every rule book has some different ones. And this latest Brains and Brawn is a Marvel set that has three characters, and it mentions being able to do like a 1v1v1 and even a like a four-way all-around skirmish. And it has some rules where, like, for the first round, you can't attack somebody like in a later in the turn order, like two people behind you or something like that, to kind of balance it out. Or it's a team mode. But really, all you're doing is your deck is your is one of your life things, because if you run out of your deck, you start losing hit points.
Actually,
and everyone
two
has,
hit points for each card you have to draw.
Yeah, and then everyone else has just like a hit point dial. Some of them have sidekicks, and some of the sidekicks have hit point dials, but some of the sidekicks are just like little one hit point guys. Like Dracula has his three. Dracula has his three sisters.
Yeah, I think that's what they're called. But also, I would like to tell you about these things called minions and heroes. Heroes are the actual like gray figures. And then there's also these little discs called minions. They don't actually have that much art on them, but they are pretty cool looking.
Yeah, and they're not just cardboard. They're like cool plastic tokens.
Yeah.
So basically you do one of three things. You can maneuver, which is movement, and you get a draw card. You can attack someone. You attack people with red or purple cards, and then people will defend with blue or purple cards. And then there's these yellow exclamation point cards you can play, which are like abilities. And you get to do two different actions on your turn. They can be the same action. And you just keep doing that over and over. I think the appeal here, it plays quickly, and just all the characters seem very thematic to who they are and what they do. What's your favorite part of the game, Bo?
Each character plays differently. Like, to be able to play them good, they all have their own unique play style. Like, Doctor Strange is just straight up weird.
You have to play them differently. Like, you have to, every person has a different kind of strategy. And that strategy might change depending on who you're playing against, too. So you kind of got to figure out the strengths and weaknesses of the characters.
Yep.
All right, well, thanks for joining us again for another Bowment with Mo.
Bo is out. Peace.
Right, and we're back talking about Sabika. Initial thoughts, I'll do it first. I was like, I saw the game initially and I was like, eh. And somebody said, hey, that's the guy that did Botoku. And I said, ooh. And so then I bought it and that's how that went. Campbell, go ahead. I'm just saying I bought it purely based on the designer. After looking at the box, I was kind of like, eh, whatever, but...
Oh, so you want my initial thoughts? I thought you were gonna say something about me, like Campbell, he may be bald, but he's handsome.
Campbell always going through Bowser's back door.
I'm one of those guys who plays every single level of the Mario game, so I rarely take the shortcut. You know what I mean?
I figured you for a flute boy.
I am kind of a fluter. Okay, so here's my initial thoughts on the game. When Rob was setting it up, and he said, hey, we're going to play Sabika, this is a Botoku guy, I was like, for whatever reason, German P. Mian, or however you say his name, I'm never, so stoked to play the new game by him, but, all of the games are awesome, and, I think they're all really fun. But as he was setting this one up, I was like, man... this looks way more down to earth than Botoku, right? Botoku's all wild. It's got those rivers and the fairies and stuff, and the little gnomes and goblins hanging out, and you Right?
You like the pumpkins and the...
I think you're missing the theming of Batoku completely, but go ahead.
Hang on. Batoku's the one where you like cross over the river and you buy it.
Yeah, but like none of those things are Japanese folklore.
Well, I'm just using my words for them.
Okay.
Where
the corn is the bananas.
Yeah. This one's very down to earth, and it looks like kind of the like maybe the most standard Euro game of all time, kind of, right? The art is really nice. The box is beautiful, and the board looks great. It's got this huge board with all sorts of stuff all over it. You basically put like most of the components of the game all out there right at the beginning.
You could probably put the board for this on the Wikipedia entry page for Euro board game.
Yeah. And it is a very large board. It's a six-fold, right? Like it's a...
Yeah, boy.
Yeah, it's got six panels. Or does it have nine panels?
It's nine.
Nine panel board game. Anyway, when we started playing it, like my initial impression of the game the first time we played, and again, this one was like, this is like the least weird thing I've played from this designer. But I don't find it any less interesting or captivating than the other games I've played. So I guess I'll dissect it in the pros and cons. But how about you guys? You want to go next, Tim?
Yeah, sure. So the table presence of the game, there is a lot on it. I mean, it's not the level of Batoku, but it definitely has a bunch of stuff all over the place. All the cards sit on the board. All the buildings are on the board. Like, there's just a lot on the board. So your first look at it is like, how am I going to parse all this information? It ends up being pretty easy.
It sets up pretty quick, though, for as crazy as that is.
For sure. But like, not knowing anything about it and just looking at it, you're like, I don't have any.
It looks
like,
intimidating.
It does, yeah. There's writing everywhere on the cards, and there's just a lot. But it definitely looks like a Euro, which Batoku looks like the opposite of that. It's got all kinds of stuff everywhere and looks crazy. So the first thought is like, how am I going to get through this game? What's the teach going to be like? It's going to be an hour teach, and it's definitely not that. So you got to, again, I think you got to get over that with.
Yeah.
It might be a theme for his stuff. How about you, Bill?
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting things that caught my eye, two things. One, this game has these cards called poems, and they are basically a way of introducing income as well as the instant injections of resources and materials into the game, and the text on that is very small. So when you talk about like standard Euro, like there's a lot to parse through, there's a lot to read, but I also agree that this game, we didn't even break out the iconography sheet to like help us, and it was still easy to navigate, and I think I got everything through the first round, even after it was all set up. And once you start playing, this is a really cool, really tight game, and I think the rondelle with the multiple layers, it kind of looks like a dartboard, is a really cool mechanic. I'm a big fan of this one.
Well, yeah, let's just get into the pros then, since you hit a couple there. I think the rondelle's really neat. I like how there's like, you get two like builders on the outside that can do stuff, and then you've got the trade guy in the middle, and then the poet in the very center. And there's only like each one can only do like I think three different actions each, and most of the actions are pretty straightforward. A couple of them are a little more involved, but the main theme between all of them is spending resources, and different resources that are worth different amounts of points because some are better than others. So when you build buildings or do the poems, you get points for building all that stuff, but then the resources all have to be different, and I think that's really cool. You can try to score points a bunch of different ways. You can try doing it by like delivering a bunch of stuff, or you could try building a bunch of stuff, or you do kind of a mix. And if you're trying to build a bunch of stuff, you can be like, well, maybe I'm going to build it and try to score a ton of points by using a bunch of resources, or you can build everything super cheap just to get it to get more stuff to maybe do something else with it.
Yeah, what's really cool about this game is it's a game about like trying to get and preserve resources in the most tactical way, because like you have your four actions, and each of your workers has the ability to kind of go take a throwaway action on their ring that like gets you a bunch of stuff. But if you can be smart about what you're doing, you can kind of collect enough things in the actions you take to like sort of keep the ball in the air. And you're trying to sort of do that as long as you can, because you only get really, you only get 20 actions in the game. So like I can go get a ton of coins with my poet, but if I don't utilize my poet very well this round, like I'm going to get one less poem or get to activate one less poem. I mean, that's one out of five times I get to use this person. So it's fun when you take the catch up actions because you get a lot of stuff and you get to go take some monster action next time. But it's even more fun to try to like sweat it out and, oh man, I didn't think I was going to get to build two buildings this round. But because things, like, I was patient and did this in the right order, I built two buildings and I got four coins on the second one. So now I can go sail my boat over here. Kind of like a constant dopamine rush if you're doing stuff right.
Yeah, having to figure out how to do the wheel. And like, you always can move two spaces for free and then you pay more for extra spaces. And you always have to move. You can't stay where you were. And you have to pay a dollar per person everywhere else, like where you land. So thinking about all that stuff, but then also thinking, well, that's too expensive for me. How else can I do it? A lot of times you can do it by building a building to do a thing, or maybe you buy a, or you sail somewhere and you get an action from a city, or you buy a poem that gives you an instant ability to do something else. Just finding the way to do the thing you want to do, you can go a lot of different ways.
So right now, I'm really excited to try the different ways of sort of juice in this game. So whether that's really exploiting the ship mechanic or the construction mechanics for resources. But I think one of the cool things that the Rondel provides is... So each one of... the actions on the Rondel can be a straightforward way of getting the thing you want, whether that's the shipping or the building of the building. But because of the way the workers stack up and the distance you are away from the actions you want to take, it can be very expensive to do those things. And when money is so tight, you have to think about like, okay, I do want to go down this track really deep, but I can't get there the straightforward way. And I think a big part of the fun in the game is figuring out like how can I chain actions that are cheaper to get where I want to go.
Yeah, and at lower player counts, there's blockers for some of the spaces that make you pay the money. That's what those gold characters were. Another pro, I played this game solo, and solo mode's really easy because it already has the blockers and you're essentially just flipping cards over to do things. So the solo on this was also very good.
Nice.
Yeah, I mean,
you play a solo mode, you're just chilling with your Pepsi like, sheesh.
The Rondel probably is the part that sings in the game that makes it, I don't know, as compelling as it is. But I think everybody mentioned the combo wombo is off the charts. Like it is, it's massive. It's I don't know. It's the way to get anything done.
You can always find a way.
You can always find a way. It's
you
like
can
almost
go through Bowser's back door.
Yeah, always through Bowser's back door. And then I so every other round, so second round, fourth round, sixth round, there's like a little scoring tile that's there that you can kind of plan towards.
The Sultan's favor.
Yeah. So, but like normally in most games, you score that round and that's it. These like stick around. So the first one you'll score it three times. The second one you score two, and the last one you score double the points for it, right?
Yeah, if you score it
but
one time.
You score it one time. I think that's really cool. Like you don't see that very often where they stay. It's usually like this is the thing that's going to score this round. Luciani does this all the time, right? It's going to score this thing, and then we're done with these
right.
items for the rest of the game. Where this sticks around, you can kind of continue to build on them and get more doors or get more, you know, handshakes or whatever they are. I really like that.
Yeah, and tonight we played with an optional advanced thing, which were events. And there's like a third of the events are good, and the other two thirds are negative. And man, we had three of them and they all seemed punishing. Basically, it was just that for the next two rounds, these things cost one more dollar. And the first time it was movement, and the second one was taking the secondary actions off the board, which were the goods tokens and the other building tokens, which I also think is cool. Did anybody talk about that yet? The secondary actions?
We haven't
actions?
Mentioned them too much in the review, no.
Yeah, like, so the two ways you can get... Basically, you take an action whenever you move your guy, but then in some spots on the board, there are the goods tokens, which you can take them, and there's room for them on your player board. Or if there already is that token on your player board, you get to, instead of taking the token off the board, you flip it and turn it into a trade good, which is what you use to go when you're sailing around.
To sail the seven seas.
Exactly. So on the outer ring, it always costs a dollar more than it costs on the inner ring. So that's another strategy thing you have to think about is... Do I want to maybe move early on an earlier ring to grab a thing for free, or do I do it later on the outer ring? And once they're gone, they're gone. So, like, you're kind of fighting over those things, too. And those can be a big deal, because if you can get the goods from there, you don't necessarily need to stop and get goods on the outer ring. This game is a lot about just finding ways to take actions without having to take the action with your worker.
Yeah. That's... literally why I called it Bowser's Back Door Castle.
I think another pro, so in our last episode, Tim did not like going last when we were playing Expeditions. I went last frequently in this game, and I thought it was awesome. I thought it was the tops.
Yeah,
it
barely matters, right?
Well, it's
yeah.
So much so that because it's a rondel and you're trying to figure out when you want to move, because some people have to move their guys out of your way at some point, and sometimes that's good
Ludicrous
or bad
style.
But like when in this game has a unique thing where that pariah track that you have to pay at the end of every round, whoever's first in that isn't just first player, they get to pick who they give first player to, which is just interesting. Like, I think everyone always just took it for themselves. But I imagine maybe there's some point where maybe you don't want to do that. I don't know. But it's cool that you have the choice. And there's not a lot of games that have that as a thing.
It is neat. And I think like it is a good trade-off, because going later lets you see which, like, you can be more patient for people to get out of your way when you're planning the stuff you're going to do. But at the same time, if you go first... you can build that building.
You are racing for things.
Nobody can stop you from doing it.
Yep. The poems. And,
or you can get to that city first.
Yeah.
Or get your boat pushed to the right and consolidate power first, because you get pee-pee and pariah when people do that. And I waited too long to explain why Bill's called pee-pee Bill. But that's prestige points, people.
That is their... they don't call them victory points in this game.
Nope, these are prestige points, or pee-pee.
Yeah, and every card... There's not a ton of iconography in the game. Almost every card has, like, a little bit... But it's all, like, written out.
Yeah.
But they don't say prestige points. They say pee-pee. So, like, every time... And this game just... litters you with like one or two or three points all over the place.
It just rains PP all over you.
But like,
all game long.
Like every time you read a card, it's like, you know, pariah and PP and, you know, whatever else. Yeah. It's like, so. Yeah.
I like that Prince song, PP Rain.
Yeah.
All right. Anybody else have any more pros before we hit them cons?
Did anybody talk about how the poems could be used as passives or instance?
Yeah, build it a little bit. Yeah, yeah.
That's neat. You get a pick.
It's like the card's divided in half, so you can kind of pick which side you want. They have a little different color.
Or there's the end game poems, too, that are always different.
Something. I tend to get too philosophical every single time we do a podcast now, and I think it's just because I'm a douchebag. Something that.
There's way too much head nodding at this table. Yeah.
I was just letting them shake it all out. Like a. Yeah. Shake, rattle, and roll. Agree with me on that one. When I was new at board games, I think there's like two types of early board game players. And there's the people who are like, I love the passive. Why would I ever not take the passive? It builds up. It's income. It's something I can always do. And then there's the people who's like, nah, give me the 7 coins. Give me the 7 coins now.
I like
now.
The red side.
Lightning bolt, exclamation point. And I'm like, I like that infinity sign. And I think it's really hard for people to get out of those kind of those habits where like...
I think you just nailed the two types of board gamers.
Yeah. But like sometimes a game comes around and just clearly demonstrates why that balance is so awesome in games of the passive versus the lightning bolt. And the poems in this game like couldn't do a better job of showing you how incredible both of those things can be.
And they're all good.
Yeah, they're
like,
all awesome.
Cam and I, okay, the beginning of this game is one of my favorite moments in gaming history. Because whenever this happens in a game, there's something magical about it. And Tim got to go first, and he took a poem.
No, Bill went first, and it was Tim's turn.
Oh, that's true.
And I was like, I got all my turns planned out. And Rob was like, do you really? I'm like, well, if Tim doesn't do exactly the thing I want to do.
So Tim took a poem, and then he took the exact poem Cam wanted.
And then
I saw how Cam reacted, so I'm like, I'm going to take a poem too. And I took the other one that maybe he wanted, and then he reacted harshly on that. And then he ended up getting something else that ended up being just as good for him.
And I was like, yeah, this is awesome.
Guess what? All those poems rock sauce. They all break the game in weird, cool ways and do neat things. This game just keeps feeding you and like drip-dropping you stuff all game. Like you think you're out of stuff, and all of a sudden you're like, I do that to get this, and I get some of this, and I get a little bit of that. And you're like, this feels good.
Yeah, super, super fun point PP drip in this game.
Yeah. The PP drip in this game is off
oh my
the
gosh.
Chain.
Oh my gosh. That drip, like a PP drip, that'd be a good name for a rapper. That'd be a good mascot for the Pepsi.
We're
for
such
the Pepsi.
Children.
PP drip is singing the chilling with my Pepsi like sheesh.
We also listen to a lot of
1993 rap. What 1993 rap songs did we listen to? We listened to 93 to Infinity.
We listened to
Bop
almost
Gun.
All of Doggy Style.
Yeah, because he mentions in Murder Was the Case that he's rolling in a 9 Trize El Do Ra or whatever he says.
Yeah. Which has nothing to do with the Sabika theme.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're just talking about it.
It's still good.
Yeah, we listen to like a lot of salsa.
That's true.
Yeah, I'm like kind of a salsa head.
3 hours of salsa.
I love salsa music.
All right, I have really just one con for this
Hit
game.
It.
Oh, I have. I bet we have the same one.
And it's the font sucks.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
that's
bad.
Not the same one.
Reading the cards. Read if you're upside down, forget about it. Like reading all and like it's such small print. There is iconography, I think, on the poems.
A little bit.
But they're
it's not clear enough to figure out.
The poems, which are super powerful and you got to know what they do, you got to like pick them up and read them probably. Yeah. Or have somebody read them at the table, whatever. Now, they don't like rotate out during the same round. So the ones that are out there for the round are out there. But in a 4-player game, there's 5 of them and there's 2 sides to each one. So there's 10 different abilities. You have to know what's up. That's my biggest thing for the game. And you know what? After you play the game a couple of times, it's like way less of a big deal. But the first time you play it, you're like, what's even going on with those?
Yeah.
And they're good.
There was multiple times this game where people were like, all right, just pick them all up and hand it to me so I can read them. You know?
Yep.
And we're 3 feet from each other.
And that doesn't happen too often. Like, I almost never ask like what's going on like a board.
Yeah.
But like there was a part in the game where like the end game scoring like for like the leftover resources was up in like the farthest part of the board away from me. And I was like, hey, Rob, what's the end game on like resources? And he goes, oh, it's right up there. And I go, guess I'm not going to know what that is. But like I've played enough games where I'm like, I bet it's just like 2 for a point or whatever. So I'll just assume that.
I mean, it is nice. All the iconography is on the board really for the game. Like even if you're trying to remember like weird rules for things, what you do is it's like all on the board. And once you understand it, like even if you're explaining the game, you don't even really need to get the rule book out to think about things. Cause you'd be like, oh, well that rule, look at that little box there. That's what this means. It's all explained fairly well.
Hey, here's my con is you get, like, we were talking about the PP rain. The PP rain is, like, a little, like, kind of hard to remember, like, how much rain you're going to collect in your rain stick. Because, like, sometimes you'll take a turn and it'll be like, oh, I just built a building and I forgot that I was supposed to get those points. But then also when I built the building, I have a poem that gave me a point for that, I think. And then, like, because of this building, I got to move my boat and I got some points there. And then also I use another poem that I use every time I have a, like, use a boat, and I got some points for that. Plus I traded some goods for some points. Like, the PP drip gets, like, kind of crazy on some turns where you're like, okay, did I count all my points just once each time? Like, did I get all of them? Did I get too many? Did I not get enough?
When in doubt, you just ask Tim to give you 10 points.
Yeah, is that how you and I both broke 100 this game?
Yeah.
Yeah, I trust that everybody does their own math, and they were like,
yeah,
give me 10 points every time. Like, I don't even ask. Yeah, I don't ask where it came from. Who cares?
Dude, you remember the time that we were playing that Viking game? Were you in that one, Rob? And there was, like, that girl who was coming to board game night. She came, like, twice, and she was, like, the most normal person that's ever gone to a board game night. And she was just, like, she was ready to play games, but she was not ready for, like, the amount of mullet behind what was going to happen to her that night. And she was, like, we were playing this game, and somebody at the table just got extremely bent out of shape over point tabulation. And I never saw her again after that. Like,
there's been, unfortunately, a couple things that happened like that. And I try to brace against it. But, you know, you can't stop people from some people.
The other time I remember very clearly a person never coming back was when, like, it was a very new gamer came in, and it was like, hey, what are you guys playing? Oh, we're playing Ticket to Ride. Oh, what are you playing? We're playing Azul. And I'd be like, oh, awesome. And then, like, she came over, and, like, Jared and, like, I think Jacob and I were setting up Argent, and they're like, what's this game? And I was like, oh, it's just, you know, like, kind of crazy, like, super complex. And Jared was like, oh, it's like Harry Potter, like, you're running a Harry Potter school or something. She's like, oh, awesome, can I play this? I was like, oh, no. If you know anything about, like, Argent, the consortium, it is one of the, like, craziest games out there for, like, somebody to just hop into that's never really played a... It's like, oh, my gosh. Have you played Argent, Bill? Mm-hmm. You played Millennium Blades with us at one time?
Yes.
It's the same designer.
Oh, okay.
So,
yeah, okay. I'd like to play Argent sometime.
It's cool. It's very cool. It's very not, like, it's not too heady if you, like, if you already, like, three weight games, but it's like, it's by the dude who did Millennium Blade, so you better believe that, like, every part of the game is pinballing off each other.
Sure.
So,
right, any other cons for Sabika?
It's just hard to read, man.
Hard
to read.
The A's
look like B's that look like J's. Like,
even for the end game cards where you have to have different, like, the end game poems, you have to have different letters for all of them. Yeah. It's hard to read those letters, too.
Yeah.
I know what they're trying to do, you know, because it's like that. That kind of scrawl that you would think about for this type of, like, region, but too much.
I think this game would benefit from not being standard box size. Like, if the board were bigger and the cards were bigger, because a lot of the cards, you know, with the poems, they're divided
you
in
want
half.
The board bigger?
I mean,
that's a big board.
It's already big enough, but I think it would help.
The card size is definitely a problem.
Yeah, the cards can be a teeny bit bigger with,
like,
a little bigger words.
Mini American or whatever cards are, like, the little tiny ones.
Yeah. If they had, like, regular sized cards.
Mean, like, those cards are fine when they're, like, in your hand and you're holding them or whatever, but when they're on the other side of a massive board sitting there upside down, it's very hard to understand.
Also, to be said, like, the board, I said it's big. But at least, like, the whole game kind of fits
it
on
does,
it.
Yeah.
There's not, like, a lot of other stuff that goes
There's
around
no card
it.
Row or...
And I guess your player boards are really good, and the iconography on your player boards is good. And, I mean, just to talk about a couple other cool things, I really like the system of putting the...
Restore your goods.
Like, the storehouses and, like, how you get points for those and, like, grow the ability to hold more things. I think that's really neat, too. And just kind of how the poems slide in and all that good stuff.
We didn't really talk about it, but starting out, you can only hold four resources.
Yep.
And then you basically get storehouses to upgrade that. So, you know, 5, 6, 7, and you get points for kind of updating them, and you stack them on top of each other. But only being able to hold 4 things at any one time is quite limiting. Just like the money. Yeah. Everything about this game is very, like, tight.
And I'd say if you're not used to this kind of game as well, a con could be that the money, I felt less bad about it this time, and we even had to pay more for stuff.
We paid a lot more, yeah.
But the money, the first time you play this game, I bet is going to feel pretty brutal to you.
Yeah.
I don't know how you felt about it, Bill. Like, where you were, like, I feel like the first couple times I played this game, I just never had money.
I think
so. Finding a good way to get money is good, like either through poems or just other ways. Otherwise, you're taking actions like literally just to get money, and that's not always the best thing to do. Like, I think the market action on the board doesn't feel generally that great, or like taking money from the poem lady because you're not then getting a poem. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yeah, for me, I'm one of those people who, like, just has taken everything and just reduced it. And so, like, in this game, for me, I get the coins, and I'm like, oh, the amount of these that I have, and, like, trying to make sure that there's enough but not too much because things feel expensive is what's fun about this game.
Yeah.
I think the one thing that was my save, I didn't feel the money pinch, but I did not ship very much. So I think next time, if I'm going to ship, I would feel that pinch hard.
That is one of the more expensive things.
That's where most of the money goes. And
yeah.
I think, like, to be competitive, I don't think you can ignore the water at all. You gotta be a boat boy a little bit.
You just
get
so much when you take the shipping action.
And again, like the poems, the shipping action has, you ship to a place, you get something instantly, you get a PP drip, and then you can push your boat to the next side of the thing where you get, again, the infinity symbol or the lightning bolt.
Yeah, bathhouse handshake, Bowser's backdoor.
We have 2 new shirts out of this thing.
Yeah, yeah,
I think you could put pee-pee drip on a shirt, and you could definitely put Bowser's backdoor on a shirt.
You guys really want me to quit the Board Boys, don't you?
So good.
I can't be part of this churlish podcast.
I mean, it all went downhill with the Chode tricorns or whatever.
I mean, what about jacking out the dudes in Oak?
That was also Rob.
Yeah. I forgot about
that. Yeah, people think I'm the most immature member of the podcast just because I am, but listen to Rob.
Oh, my wife would agree when I laugh at everything Bo says.
Yeah.
Bo had a funny moment earlier when somebody said something silly, and from another room, Bo went, "Hey!"
Perfect comedic timing.
Yeah, it was great timing. All right, well, let's hit the final thoughts on the Board Boys podcast. We have a 3 Boeing scale, 0 being the worst, 3 being the best, half Boeing's allowed. 1 time only, you can give your 4 Boeing. Man, when are we going to give a 4 Boeing?
What are we doing, TI4 with Prophecy of Kings?
You'll give it to that?
Probably.
Okay.
What are we doing, Can't Stop 2?
Electric Boogaloo. Sorry, I can't not do that joke.
We should totally do Can't Stop.
A 0 Boeing game in Sabika is you don't got no money, you don't got no pee-pee drip.
Rob and Tim take all your poems.
Yeah. Rob and Tim takes all your poems.
Dude, I resolved right then and there to win the game.
You
and
can't,
I did.
Like, you're not going to be the next poet laureate.
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, your Alhambra just, it smells funny.
Yeah.
The 3 Boeing game is, like, you have a thriving, you're like a thriving merchant in the Alhambra, and you just shipped the biggest load of stuff to Tim.
my Bowser Castle.
You got many poems.
Yeah.
You have many poems. Yeah. Man, I can't even think of a good one for this, but
yeah, Bowser's backdoor castle. Yeah, you have your your boat from the left to the right side on that. Save the princess.
Yeah, it has both a infinity symbol and exclamation point in Bowser's castle. Yeah, you're just smashing.
Yeah, I mean, everything's coming up infinity symbol / exclamation point for you.
Yeah, lightning bolt
everywhere.
End game sign.
All right. Well, I went last time. I'll go first this time. I know Campbell said like this designer in his games, but in all honesty, Campbell,
I know three.
We've only played 3 of them, and he only has 5 or 6.
The one I really want to play is Orb Hunter. That one looks cool, doesn't it?
Yeah. But yeah, so Botoku, Sabika, and then Bamboo.
Yeah, if I'm being honest, I always think this is the same guy that did Gugong.
Oh, okay. Andreas Stenning.
And Stroganov.
Yep. Nope. Different.
Which?
For me, though, Sabika has been a hit. It's right up there with Botoku for me. 2.5 boings. Staying in the collection. I've been trying to play it recently, and we finally got to play it again tonight. But like to remind myself of how to play the game, it was not hard. It's one that you can get back out to the table fairly easily, I think, especially because all the iconography is so good. So,
I have just one very important question, because I've only played this game twice.
Yes.
At the end game thing, like where we had to get 6 ships in a row, does that come from a deck of many different things you're shooting for?
But they all have to do with the water.
Okay.
So that one, the other reason why I think you can't really ignore the water is there's an end game card that specifically deals with like trading stuff. So
how many poems are there? Like 30?
Probably more than that.
More than we saw.
Yeah.
And there's like twice as many endgame poems.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a lot of content. When I was thinking about what I would give this game,
there's also more city tiles than we used.
Yeah. So here's my rationale. When I play a Euro game that has a lot of similarities to many other Euro games, because I think you could argue that this one's not necessarily doing stuff that other games aren't doing. And so I think, like, is there enough in the game that I would play it differently every time because of the way the game is that time? And I think about how certain types of buildings are slightly better because you get extra points for them. There's a different endgame goal. I might have completely different poems. Well, that makes you feel pretty good about the longevity of something like this. Is it unique? Not really. Is it well executed? Absolutely. I think I'm going to say that this would always be a 2.5 for me, but I don't know if I'd ever get a 3. We'll see after more plays. But tonight I want to say 2.5.
Yeah, I think I am also at a 2.5 on this one.
Bill.
That's been my highest rating so far.
Nice. Yeah. Put that on the box.
PP Bill approved.
PP Bill approved.
I think this felt very much like Woodcraft a little bit. And not just the rondel, but just how all the parts sort of...
It's kind of Woodcrafty, I feel.
Yeah, fit together, and all the mechanics. And yeah, I really enjoyed it. And then when you were reading the theme and discussing the theme, like that adds a layer on top of it too. So yeah, I was very, very satisfied with this one.
All right. No, I'll round it out. So I think Cam and I probably sit in this boat a little bit more maybe than you, Rob, but I this game like shines in the being able to complete actions without doing that action.
Yeah.
You just get it all Love over it. The place. All like, and I think that's what really hooks me into games, is being able to kind of do that and wobble your way into accomplishing your goals when maybe the path is not available to you in the clearest way. So
I love that too.
Yeah. Okay. So I think for me, 2.5 on this one too. This is a very good game. I'd love to play it some more.
So was that 2.5 all around?
I don't know that it's a 3, and I'm sitting on, I do not like it as much as I like Botoku right now.
I haven't played Botoku for a little while, which, you know, just lead us right into what we're doing next, Tim.
Yeah. So we look back a year in the past on the Board Boys podcast to something we call Bump or Dump. Right now it's going to be Botoku. Cam, you want to hit us with that theme song?
Yeah. Baby, turn around. I want to see that German P. Milling game go Board Boy Bump.
Or Dump.
Rob's 100% asleep right now.
He's out. A year ago we did Botoku on a podcast. It was the three of us again, just a three person podcast here. So
just the three.
It
of
was
us.
An 8 on BGG for 572. Bump or dump?
It has to have bumped.
I'm going to go with...
It's a 7.9 right now.
I bet it's in the 200s.
Mm-hmm. Let's say bump.
I'll say bump.
I'm going to say 252.
Cam?
I said bump.
What, you got a number for me?
Yeah, I think it's 9.
Nine?
Okay.
Yeah, right. It's not, dude, it's not Gloomhaven. Come on.
Not nine.
Yeah. So 317. So it was a bump. Yeah, not quite 200, but a good bump. I really like Motoku, man. That's such a good game.
Sabika is definitely more of a Cam game, but Motoku is definitely has the unique factor. Yeah.
It's wild. Iconography, the game.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's wild.
It's kinda,
yeah.
It's crazy bonkers with iconography, but it's super fun. I wish that game was on BGA.
Yeah, me too.
That'd be a fun BGA game. The card play in that is neat. I really like the card play. Why don't we have time to just play all the games?
Yes. Why is it that Motoku feels kind of Bjorkish to me?
I could see that. It's probably the
I could see young Bjork like on a documentary talking about like a dream she had, like, and I dreamed I was in, you know, like, I can't do Bjork.
Did I have Motoku at a 2.5?
You had Motoku at a 3.
Oh, well, then I must like Motoku more than Sabika as well.
I didn't say I liked it more, but I said that I would say there are two sides of a very nice coin.
Yeah.
All right. So if you'd like to give us feedback on the Bump or Dump, you can do so through our Board Game Geek Guild. You can find that on the website. Nate Simmons, solid game. He got it. He's busting it out less than a month ago, and it's still hitting the table for him. 2.5 boings. And then Chris Boat, it's in his top 10.
Boatman. Whoa.
Boings. Yeah. Yeah.
Love
Loves
it.
Motoku.
That's great.
Yeah.
AKA Hila Hila Hila.
Yeah.
On Discord.
Yeah. Good. Like, Out of the three words said at the same time, Hila 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 is almost as good as Tony Tony Tony.
It also had exclamation points in it,
yeah.
Which we know.
So does Tony Tony Tony.
I always thought, I think Chris Boat is more of a Infinity player, though. I guess, Chris, you can tell me what you think, if you're the Infinity player or the exclamation point player. I don't know which one I am. I think I'm somewhere in the middle,
I think
you have to pick one. So
I don't think you do, Rob.
You don't have to pick one.
I think understanding the delicate balance between the exclamation point and the infinity symbol is what makes you an Omni gamer. What makes you somebody who can see, if you can see all sides of the sphere, then you're playing 4D.
Cam needs a philosophy course.
I love.
Dude, I'm gonna start wearing weird suits and like start talking like with a. They're gonna start making memes about me.
I'm way more of an instant gratification guy. I had 2 blue poems tonight and only 1 red, but I want to say I normally have more red poems. So, chalk me up to exclamation point.
The way I was gonna say I was indecisive, but I think the way I play TI showcases that I'm a exclamation point player. I'll go big, I'll flame out, and I'll die early.
I think the point of this podcast is, in a world of exclamation point and a world of infinity symbol players, be a Bowser's backdoor castle. Like, you don't blaze your own trail.
on that note, thanks for listening to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast. Season 13.
If you didn't know, you could go through the back door of the castle in Super Mario World to win the game on like after like 15 minutes of play. Sorry for spoiling it for you. The game's been out 35 years, so what do you want?
Go check us out at theboardboys.com. There you can find links to our Discord. Come chat with us. You can find links to our Patreon. Come support us. We'd appreciate it. Speaking of our Patreon, our patrons, I'd like to shout out Hammond Buckland, BJ from Board Game Gumbo, Shifty Teeth, David Dugas, Andre Bosch, Jeremy Toman, Braden Dowdy, Rob Cooper, Richard Lane, and Board Game Bastard.
We dem boys.
Also, hit us up. We got the Facebook, the Instagram. Like us. The more followers we get, the better off we are.
I think we have a
also,
TikTok.
Also, 5-star iTunes reviews.
We have a Discord.
Cam, you should make a TikTok.
Make a Bowser TikTok.
Yeah. Dude, you will go viral with Bowser's backdoor TikToks. I think you could make that a trend.
There's enough backdoor TikToks on. Like, that's kind of one of the problems I have with the app, is that, like, every time I get on there to make, like, just a fun board game TikTok, it's just nothing but backdoors. It's like...
Like, you know that that's, like, tailored for your viewing, like, from your history, right?
I was telling, no, it's... Like,
I'm pretty sure it's... You've been looking at Bowser for 7 hours a day on TikTok.
I was telling my friend Tim the other day that my problem with TikTok, too much booty cheek, not enough turn the other cheek. You know what I'm saying? Just saying.
All right. Well, until next time, we hope you like board games.
Boing, boing, boing.